Oh, I think I did it. I think we got it. Yes. Okay, good. Now I'll shut it off. Right. Oh, what kinds of techie stuff going on? Hope everybody had a great week. Already got a question in. Let's see. How was NCAAs? Well, we're gonna look at a little bit of it. And Barbara and I were talking this morning. We're probably gonna do we'll next week's Zoom might be all about NCAAs. And so we'll figure it out. Yeah, Brian, I just saw that you had sent me the word on Adam Peaty. So get this. Luke Guy, who is James Guy's brother, who we work pretty closely with, is actually at the meet and will be filming the races in the GoSwim app. And I will get them here after the races. He didn't get there this morning, but he'll be there tonight. So we'll have Adam's final swim. And he told me this morning, I had a meeting with him today, and he said that after Adam went the 58 this morning, he texted because they're friends. And so he texted Adam and said, "Welcome back, mate." And Adam wrote back and said, "I never left." So he's ready, and he basically said that if he goes 57 tonight, that he's ready for anybody in Paris. So it's exciting, to be kind of that close to it. But I will be getting his races because Luke is going to be filming all the top guys that his brother swims with, and we'll have it. So with data and everything. So I'm looking forward to that. So we'll start off today. First of all, everybody can hear me okay? Somebody yell at me to make sure that I can hear you.
Yes, you can. We can.
Thank you. Everybody's so quiet.
Did you want to
Thank
start recording?
you. Oh yeah, good. Let's do it. I mean, the good thing is it's over on YouTube, but thank you very much. That was my friend Monty, it sounded like. There we go. All right, excellent. So, yeah, the first thing I wanted to look at today, because we are talking about freestyle, I wanted to look at just a little bit of what I thought was the most impressive swim at NCAAs. And I've been asked by quite a few people what really struck me. And we're definitely going to talk about it next week. I told Barbara this morning I want to get t-shirts made, and the t-shirt should say, "What's your percentage?" And what that means is, how much of your race do you swim underwater? Because, if we're teaching young athletes, and again, like I said, I'm swimming much more these days as well. And how much I spend underwater in comparison to most people is much less, much less than what we saw at NCAAs. However, I still try to make sure that my feet are past the flags before I start swimming. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm doing a bunch of dolphin kicks. It's basically dive, push off, glide, one dolphin, and then have my breakout stroke. So I'm taking much more advantage of just gliding off the wall. But if we're coaching and teaching young athletes and we want them to have a chance, then what struck me was how long everybody spends underwater, and especially short course. And I did have a conversation with someone from USA Swimming while we were there. And of course, the question was, how will this translate to long course, to the Olympics? Almost as an excuse sort of thing that, it's NCAAs. So it works from a short course standpoint, but how's it going to transfer to long course? Look, it's a skill. And we have to also remember that there's very few people that are going to swim in the Olympics. And so you know, when we've got high school swimming and college swimming here in the United States and short course swimming all over the world, this is something that is going to be very, very important at all levels of the sport, to the point that I have said, and you guys have probably heard me say it many times, who is going to be the first person to swim a mile going to the 15 meter mark on every underwater? So 1500, so you have 30 turns, 29 turns. Who's going to be the first person going to 15 on every one of them? Because we just saw, and I'm going to show you here, I'm going to show you the first 100 or 200 of a 500 free. That was the most impressive swim of the meet. 402 500 freestyle. It was insane. I mean, literally, it was one of the most impressive things I have ever seen in, you know, 55 years in swimming. So let's go ahead and share the screen. So one of the things I want to get across is that, what is the pace of a 500 free? So how are you supposed to take out a 500 freestyle? We're about to see. This is a 500 free. To humans, it looks like 100 free. Look at the breakout point. Look at the breakout point. So you can imagine he's going short course. And so when you think about it from a short course standpoint, it's harder to spend this much time underwater because you have less time to recover your air than long course. I mean, long course, you've got 35 meters to get back. Whereas short course, you don't have that long. And especially as fast as he's going, because we can look over to the other side, we can look at the data on this, and we can start to see how much time he literally has to get his air back. It's a big race. There's a lot of data in it, as you can see. So we switch over here. Look at the breakout distance. Barely under 10 yards the entire race, and lengthened it towards the end. So he is almost 50% of his entire race for a 500 free was done underwater. Almost 50%. Let's say maybe 40, 45% is done underwater. And this is what I'm talking about, is that when you look at the data, when you look at the stroke data, oh, let me get my markup. Okay. We got this much from here to here on each lap is underwater. And so again, if this is not what we're teaching our young athletes, and I said it last week or the week before, go coach soccer. Because it's, I mean, this is the sport. And yeah, long course, you're going to have to be a great swimmer as well. But the reality is, this is the sport. So with that said, that's all I wanted to show on that. But it is impressive. I have loaded it up to the website. I will load up all the races. And I think, you know, what I did on the website is I put it up as have all the data in it. But if you just export the video, it's a normal video. So I'll probably put it up as well. Because it's really, you know, like the 400 free relay at the end of the meet, I wanted to record before it started, and I wanted to keep it recording afterwards for a little bit, just to give the feeling of what it's like to be there. And it is by far the most exciting swim meet on the planet. Okay. And the reason is, and actually, you know, it's funny, Luke Guy was talking to me this morning, and he said, what was it like to be there? And I tried to explain to him that the difference between NCAAs and the Olympics or World Championships or something like that is that 90% of the audience at the Olympics are spectators. Maybe 10% are the participants. Whereas when you get to NCAAs, 90% of the people there have a vested interest in something that's going to happen. They're either parents, they're alumni, they're the athletes themselves. And so it is the loudest meet on the planet, because you can't believe how long it takes the crowd to quiet down after the official blows their whistle. And so the guys are in the take your mark position for maybe 10 to 15 seconds before people shut up, because everybody's trying to get the last cheer in. And then it goes completely dead silent. And then as soon as the beep goes, it explodes in noise again. And it is so cool, because everybody wants their swimmer, their alumnus, their kid. Everybody's screaming for something, even to the point that you're screaming for teams to score more points than other teams, even if your guy's not in the race, because you want someone else to win to help your team position. And that was especially true with ASU this time, which was very cool. So again, it was really cool to be there. We got to see our friends win the meet, which was very exciting. And then if you haven't heard the news, the swimming world exploded yesterday. 2 days after Bob wins for ASU, he is now the director of swimming for University of Texas. So it was, they had a day and a half to enjoy the victory. And now he's moving to Austin, Texas. Biggest job in swimming. So there's so much that goes along with it, but it's definitely the biggest job in swimming, and he is deserving of that job. So, all right. So let's go ahead and look at the videos from part three in teaching freestyle, which is mostly about the arms today. So again, I don't think I can mute everybody. Yeah, I'm going to mute everybody, but if you have something to say, please unmute. I'm only muting because of if there's background noise or something like that. So if you have a question or a comment, then speak up. Okay. So we're starting off with how to control the arms. And again, this is a great warm-up tactic. I like this from a warm-up standpoint because it opens up the arms. You're not doing the same thing. And so this is something that I've done for a long time, even still today. And that is basically you start off with a few strokes of fingertip drag. And then you just lift the arm a little bit to get into a low and relaxed recovery. And then you move into a straight arm or very big recovery. Okay. So one of the reasons I do this is because I feel like it opens up things. You're not just going through the same motions. And so you're trying to add some flexibility, and you're going to move the arm a little bit different each time. And so I think it's an easier way to warm up. But when we really get into it, okay, and especially when I think about how I would give this to a young athlete or really just anybody, the idea here is that when people get in for warm-up, and this was also something that Barbara and I talked about this morning, is that one of the things to watch when you go to NCAAs is warm-up. And again, just like when I was up with the British team in Flagstaff, they spend a lot of their time with fins and swimming very slowly with fins on. To get that feeling of that sense of the water going past you, but the fins are doing most of the work. And so the whole idea here is having a purpose. When you look at people generally warming up, and especially young swimmers and those of us that, back in the water, you just kind of go back and forth. And, you know, whether you have a purpose to it, whether there's a real, meaning behind it, we do like to make sure, and again, referencing someone like Steve Hoffler, we want to make sure that everything you do in the water has a purpose, because you're building some awareness. Every time you're in the pool, there is awareness because the water's touching you. And so when you demand an action from someone, or you demand an action for yourself, it takes thought. And when you add thought to physical movement, you start to learn. And so it's not just necessarily about doing this exercise, but it is about having a purpose initially as soon as you get in the water, rather than just going back and forth. And so the fingertip drag is very exacting. You want to make sure that you're touching the water, that you're connected, So Leslie says more emphasis now on dry land activation first before hitting the water. I was thinking today in a, I don't know if it's in a couple of weeks, I got to go to Texas to, for a conference. And one of the other people that's going to be speaking there is Jessica Hardy. And, I've been asked to introduce Jessica for her talk. And so I'm going back and thinking of things that I'm going to say about her. And, Leslie, one of the things that you brought up, it strikes me as Jessica, who is a great sprinter, who did so much activation on land that she didn't do any warm up. She would get in immediately and start sprinting almost right away because all of her activation was done on land. So it is absolutely true, Leslie, what you just typed into the chat, that much more emphasis is going on dry land activation, but it's been going on for a while at certain levels of the sport. But now more people are starting to understand that more in the water just isn't necessarily better, but it's going to be how you do things. So again, that's exactly what I'm talking about here, is making sure that there is an assignment or a purpose to almost everything you do in the pool. And so just these simple little actions, in order to do them correctly, means you have to think about them. You cannot necessarily be disengaged because, you know, if you give it a number, so we'll say 1, 2, fingertip drag, 2, relaxed recovery, and 2, straight arm recovery. And so again, giving a purpose right away also not only allows the person to vary their recovery, which is good in order to find the right recovery that works for you, but at the same time, you know they're not just in there going back and forth mindlessly, which is the danger of the sport. Mindless back and forth does not serve well.
Glenn, if I could just ask a question with regard to that first video. One of the things that I notice in it is that the straight arm recovery still has an awful lot of body roll. It's not mentioned in your narration of the piece. But what I find with so many of my masters who do swim with a straighter arm, they're staying really flat in the water. So I would think that you want to present this 3 variations as that straight arm has got to go really high in the air, not smacking the person that's going in the opposite direction in your lane, which I find is what happens when a lot of people think, oh, I want a straight arm recovery. It's way off to the side.
Great point, Greg. And that is, again, you know, we can look at the Andy Murez videos in the endless pool where she is perfectly on her side. So if the arm is raised up here, the body needs to rotate unless you've got some very strange flexibility in your shoulders. And so the higher that you bring this arm, the more body rotation is going to occur as well. Exactly what Greg said. So yesterday, I got to Northwestern yesterday, and the pool, the long course pool is set up short course. So I think there's 20 lanes in it. Of course, every one of them is filled with one person. Okay. So I had to find a spot that I could swim with somebody. And so what I'm looking for is anyone that has a sense about them that they've done this before. Okay. Because I want to make sure when I get in the lane with someone that not only do they know I'm there, but at the same time, I have to look at their arms, because if I'm using paddles or something like that and we hit, it's going to hurt them more and it's going to hurt me. And then they're going to yell at me, you know, so I'm very aware of my surroundings, but there are a lot of people when you go to the pool that are doing what Greg says. And so if there are a couple people in the lane, I'm looking for the lane where the person's arm is not coming across my lane, because I want to make sure that I'm not going to hit anybody. So I'm trying to be courteous, but at the same time, it's like, you got to sight the course when everybody wants their own lane. And when you got to share with someone. So these, exactly what Greg's talking about, is something that you want to avoid, because if you see the lane line over here, it's there. This person's arm is maybe swinging halfway into your lane. And so, you know, by doing this sort of motion, especially if you're doing this exercise, to have that arm go high, it does impact the rotation of the body. And again, it's protective of everybody at the same time. So great point, Greg. Thank you. Okay. This is one of our athletes in New York City. So if you were to just look at this, very, very high head position. I know that, let's say someone like Steve, and I don't know if he's here today or not, but he is very, very committed to making sure that his athletes never do anything wrong. So when you're teaching these sorts of exercises, first thing you have to know is, does the athlete know what the proper positioning is? So when we take someone and we put their head into this position, really out of line, we know it's going to impact their body line. So this is not something that you do for a long period of time, but at the same time, you want to marry that visual with the feeling. So it's like, what does it look like and what does it feel like? And so you have two sensory activations going on in this particular exercise. The first one is you're looking to see what the hands are doing. And the second thing is you're feeling what the hands are doing. So we want this position, but we want to make sure that they know that they're doing it correctly. So we say, watch it, lift your eyes and watch what you're doing. So when we look at this, and you've heard me say this so many times before, look at the upper arm and look at how he gets into position. So the isolation of the upper arm, the entire arm is not falling at the same time, but the lower arm from the elbow to the fingers, that's what we want to get into this position. So by lifting the head and watching your arms do it, you get a sense of what it's supposed to feel like. So isolate the upper arm and get the arm into that EVF or early vertical forearm. And so really looking and feeling it. So I love that we put paddles on for this, okay? My swim bag's in the closet. I love the new Manta paddles by Finice because they have a little tilt to them that allows you to get your fingers down into this position. So when you first start to do this, one of the things to be aware of is he's going a little fast here, okay? So he's swimming pretty fast. Now, for those of us that don't swim this fast anymore, I use the paddles and I try to think of both sides of the paddle. Okay. Not just the front of the paddle that we pull with, but I want to feel and experience the back side of the paddle as well. So the side that my hand is on. Excellent. Thank you, Baron. So the link to the Manta paddles, Baron put them in the chat. And so these are my favorite paddles. These are the ones that I use. So if you look at that, you can go check them out. But the idea here, even with the flat paddle, is that right here, and you know the way I think about water, all this water up here, everything around is still, okay? It might have some disruption to it because of other swimmers, but the reality is you're kind of going into water that's just sitting there. And so when you think about that water as a substance, when the hand goes to this position, you're going forward, and this still water here will impact that paddle. It will actually push it down. And so rather than having all the force be on this, feel the water, take that extra surface area and push the hand down. And what you'll feel is a slip. Okay. So it'll fall into that position. So from here to there, the hand will simply fall, and we've got the upper arm isolated. Let's see if we get it on one of the other ones here. So right there, it falls. And so imagine the water pressing on the back. Now, you're really only going to feel like this if you go slow enough to feel, okay? And right now, I'm swimming slow enough to feel it on just about every stroke. But for someone like him, he's going to be focused on the push, on more of the power sense of it. But I want you to think about it in getting into this position, you know, getting over that barrel or whatever you want to call it. But the idea is by the increased surface area, you can actually let the paddle, or as they say, let the tool do the work. Let the tool take your hand into that position, and then you get a sense of what it's supposed to feel like. Right here, let's see, where was it? Oh, I'm looking at the wrong one. Yeah, 25.3. Look at that. You right here, look at how, imagine that both arms were in this exact position at this point, and he was at the wall climbing out of the pool. That's the feeling that I get from this, is that that's the position when you're climbing out of the pool, how you want your arms. A lot of power right there. Now he does it again here on the other side, 26 second mark. Right there. So imagine right there, this is someone climbing out of the pool. That's the initial move on climbing forward. So instead of climbing in that direction, you're climbing in that direction. So you're climbing forward rather than up. But that is beautiful. That's just a beautiful shot right there. So I love that one. Let's go up to 36. And again, he's watching the hands. So start with this very elevated head position. Keep your eyes on what you're doing. And then again, build the sensation of what it feels like when you know you have it in the right position. The next time through, take the head. Let's see, where is it? 44. Yeah, he's watching the hands again and then starts to lower the head ever so slightly until we get to back to right there. The head is going down. And then we get back into the normal swimming position, and we're still trying to maintain that feeling of the arms. So start high and then start to take your head down back to a regular swimming position, but maintaining that feeling. Thank you, Helen. So is he bending the wrists prior? We're going to get to that, Monty. We're going to talk about the wrists and we will talk about. So right there is what you're talking about. So right there, he is starting to set that up. And we're going to talk about that in one of the upcoming videos, because this is very, very subtle. Okay. Because when he gets to here, where's the bend in the wrist? So that's what we want to make sure. If you're going to bend the wrist, boy, you really got to know how to do it. Okay. Because our goal is to have this, which is this flat surface area, especially while we're pushing back. So, all right, let's get on to the next one. Make sure my notes are right. So hand entry. Okay. So delicate, very delicate, you know, the relationship. And you've heard me talk about this before from a standpoint. If the arms are in a straight arm position and they come in all at the same time, then the arm, your initial instinct is to push down with the entire arm. So, and we have to take a lot of what we're talking about here as an idea that we are first teaching someone how to swim and teaching the recovery of the arms and all that before we start to really identify how they're going to swim fast. Okay. So we're going to be very careful to make sure we say that this is part of the process. So the first thing is delicate fingers in. So fingertips first, and then rotate and extend forward. So fingertips first. Now, if you really want to get into this, one of the exercises you can extrapolate this out to is silent swimming, okay? So it's very delicate. You know, the hands go in, you're very soft on the water, and then you move that forward to what I call loud swimming, which is where does the arm make noise? Okay. So if your arm is going to make noise, and I make noise when I swim, so a lot of impact with the surface of the water, what part of the arm makes that impact? And those of us that have been doing these Zooms together for 3 years, we know the answer to that. So the hand doesn't make noise, because this is what young swimmers, when I ask the question, what part of your arm makes noise? And they said, well, the hand. No, it's here. Okay. So when the fingertips go in, and when we get into the hip rotation, you're going to see that the splash right here, as the arm extends forward, the elbow falls onto the surface of the water, and there is the impact. And so what in the endless pool, one of the things I'd like to do, and you can see where the water's going. So the splash of the water is coming this way. As the left arm enters, the splash goes to the right. As the right arm enters, the splash, there's more over here going to the left, okay? So what I would have the young kids do is I'd stand, if I was standing on this side of the pool, I tried to get them to splash me with the left arm, okay? But the arm couldn't come across like that. It had to go straight. And so what I call smashing the elbow at that point. So smashing the elbow down, because if the fingertips get in cleanly, right there, if they're already in, as you smash this down, Greg, that's another thing that will, by smashing that down, will rotate the body around. Okay. So if you take some impact on this, smash it, and then boom, it rotates over. So that does help some people. Always remember, when you tell someone to accelerate one part of the stroke, chances are they accelerate everything. So we have to extend, we smash to extension when we're teaching this. So again, that's just my words. You can use anything you want. It's the one that worked for me, is clean fingers, smash the elbow, initiates better extension and rotation all at the same time, because you're going from this position. And then as you kind of get that elbow down and drive the arm forward, everything spins around. So this is what I like about this. And I know that wasn't necessarily the point of this exercise, but I thought this was a great shot to show that. Okay. So as Patrick comes here, now here's a bit of trivia. Okay. So this guy, I think I've told you before, was the ASU school record holder in the 200 fly, as well as a great 50 freestyler. And so we can look at his stroke and we'll see that his arms are straighter. He was asked to speak to the team at NCAAs before the last night of finals. And so Patrick is a big alum of ASU. And so it was quite an honor for him, obviously, to be able to speak to the team before they went out and won their first NCAA championship. And it's just very cool. So he was very excited. And I actually texted with him today to see how everybody's doing since Bob made the announcement. And so happy and sad, obviously. Okay. Fingertips first, drive to extension. And now we've got clean fingers. So when you're working with people, one of the things that you're looking at is how much air do they carry into the catch? And why do they carry air into the catch? And so generally air will stay when there's pressure, and air will fall off when there's none. And so you can carry air down pretty consistently, but if you extend even a little bit, if you come in and extend even a little bit with balance, the air falls off. Okay. So just that extension, you're going to have the fingertips come in, carry air, smash the elbow down, and that extension of the arm, look at that. It's just on the back of the fingertips right there, but there's nothing on the front. And so the idea here is that that's a balanced body moving forward. And because of that, during extension, there's no air being carried by the hands. And so we've got a clean pull. Let's look at Merrillet. So just a little bit of extension, boom, all the air is gone by the time she gets into the catch. There might be a little bit that's carried on the back of the hand, but mostly it's clean. And so when you're teaching someone, you are watching to see how clean the hands are to make sure that they're not leveraging, because you'll see tons of swimmers that, especially when they breathe, the opposite arm from when they breathe, they carry air the whole way down and around, because that arm is being used for leverage and pushing down, which air does not necessarily leave you. But as soon as you start to go forward, the air will fall off. Let's see. Brian says, yeah, the Finis fulcrum paddles. So Baron, if you can pull those up. And if anybody in there, go to the chat in a second. Baron will put the link in for the Finis fulcrum paddles. They look like a figure eight, okay? And the figure eight, if you take that, it goes on the back of the hand and on the back of the wrist, or the back of the forearm. So it you kind of snake your hand through it. And so what you have to do is you have to push back up like this in order to keep it on. If the wrist breaks, it falls off. And so they have small ones for kids, and it's great to use. So we didn't have that in today's example of straight wrist, Brian, but that's a very good point. So the forearm fulcrum paddles are very good from that standpoint. Okay, so there she goes. Beautiful, very nicely done. All right. So extend front to back. So you want to make sure that you're teaching people to have a full range of motion on the pull. Now, we can get into all kinds of stuff as far as tempo and rate and where you give up anything on the stroke. If you want to increase tempo or if you want to make the stroke easier. But when you're teaching someone, you want to make sure that you're showing the full range of motion. Okay. So full extension in front, full extension in back. Okay. So full range of motion. I mean, we can get into the Roland Schumann video, Olympic champion. And he talks about from, you know, the full range of motion, pushing all the way back. And so making sure that we're not shortchanging the exit of the stroke too much. And so teaching this, however, we have to make sure that we understand physics and we understand the laws of water, hydrodynamics, and all that good stuff. So front to back, look at that. Fully extended in front and fully extended in back. Making sure that I've got the right one up here, right? So looking at my notes. Yeah, so front to back. Okay, let's go to Patrick. And I think this was the picture that I liked the best. Look at that. Okay, so that's fully extended in front and fully extended in back. Now, this is where the palm gets... It's very important to understand that we want that full range of motion in the back. However, the hand has to exit properly. If the hand doesn't exit properly, then that pushing in the back can be detrimental to hip rotation. Okay. It can stagnate you or stall you a little bit. So what I want you to notice, and you can go through almost any of the high level Olympic sprinters in GoSwim or anything, wherever you can find them, watch. If you can, see how their hand exits in the back. And this is very important because if the hand is fully connected all the time, all the way through, so if Patrick takes his hand, and so right here, the palm is still facing back. If he pushes the palm up, okay, the hips are supposed to be releasing at this point on the exit. If he pushes up with that hand with too much force, it pushes the hips down. Okay. So watch his hand as he exits. So we're talking about full range of motion, but it's very important how the hand exits. Watch what it does. Pinky first. Slice, exit to full extension. Okay. So you can watch it. And it really is one of those things where, you know, if you're watching someone swim and you're teaching them how to swim and you're working with them and they got this big flip out of the back because they're wanting to finish up. And so the flip of the water goes way in the sky. Chances are they're pushing up at the end of the stroke, which is going to slightly inhibit the ability to open the hips up, which then gets some power. Because if you're pushing this way, you're pushing the hips that way. And so when I went back and I started looking at all of the sprinters, Jason Lezak and Roland Schumann and, you know, all the sprinters, they all slice their hand out at the end. Now it might be just a turn at the very last second or instant, but they slice the hands out of the back. So let's watch Patrick again. Full extension. Watch the hand. Look at that. Sideways. And again, this is a 19 second 50 freestyler. Now I know we just saw everybody at NCAAs go 18, but 19 is still pretty fast. Okay. So that was a race, and the 100 free, goodness gracious. There were five guys under 41 in the 100 free. Think about what that heat looked like. I mean, they talk about the wave that follows the swimmers. It's massive. You've got eight large men going so fast that the wave that follows them, you could probably surf on it. It's just incredible. Okay. So when you're doing this, be aware that you want full extension of the arm, but make sure you're not pressing up at the end.
Glenn, I'm going to interrupt once again, because
absolutely.
As much as I find that many of my swimmers have no problem exiting pinky first, it's because their hand slips to the side as it goes by the waist, as opposed to waiting in that till that tail end. So every once in a while I get somebody who splashes up a lot of water, but I'd say it's rare with my masters, certainly. So I tend not to talk too much about this pinky out and really try to get them to push all the way to the back. How often do you find that it becomes a problem for people, and so you want to talk about that turn to the side?
I have a lot of, if I do find this on someone, I have someone, I would generally, from a fixed standpoint, have them brush their palm against their thigh as they exit. So just flatten it out like that. So that seems to help. You know, Greg, the most people that I have issues with on this are competitive swimmers around my age that were taught to flip out of the back. And so we have to kind of take that away from them a little bit. Brian says he talks about leading the finish with the heel of the hand. So pushing that way, which also will kind of drag the fingers out. Okay. But this is where, again, that feel for the water becomes very important. And one of the sculling drills that you can do is the hands back behind you with, let me see if I can get it. So you're doing this at the end, which puts the heel high. And then you can practice that sort of movement. So there is some connection back there for some of them. Another question, any thoughts or suggestions on entering the hands finger distance? Just make sure that you can get them in. And so you'll have to over-exaggerate with some people and you tell them, go put them in at the head and then they'll get it out here. But if it's fully extended out there, you have to see what part of the arm enters first. So it really, you just want to make sure that the fingertips are coming in first and driving to extension. Even the big time sprinters, you look at Ben Proud in the 50 free from the UK, he's got a full straight arm recovery, but his hands enter more articulated like this to make sure that the hands are going in and then drive right into the catch. And so you'll see some of this if you watch, if we get video of the 50 free, you'll see the hand articulated a little bit coming with a straight arm, but with the fingers piercing just slightly before the rest of the arm. So what Leslie says is the alternate school of thought is the early exit. And that's why I have this picture up here right now, because this is one of the standard exercises is, you know, on your suit, where does the hand exit? Okay. And so on a full recovery, the hand is exiting almost at the bottom of the jammer suit. Okay. And then what you do is you take your thumb and you say, okay, I'm going to pull it out in the middle of the suit. And so you try to hit your hand going out there, which would then lift the elbow. And then you shorten it up even more by saying, I will touch my thumb on the side above my suit. And then you've got a very early exit on the back. But when you do these exercises, my train of thought is that you can always vary the back part of the stroke. Okay. You can change tempo. You can change force production. You can do a lot of things in the back of the stroke that will change your rate, change how much power you use, but don't make any adjustments as far as, sorry about that, the front of the stroke. You still want this to occur, especially in the teaching format. You can vary the back of the stroke, but you should always make sure that you're reaching full extension in the front, especially when you're learning swimming skills. And so this is a very deep exit. And so varying where you release the hand or how you bring it out, you can just use your thumb as a guide from that standpoint. Thumb tag is what Nancy said. An angle of the forearm relative to the surface of the water. Is there a best angle? Monty, are you talking about entry or catch?
Entry.
Okay. So obviously you don't want it too steep because it'll take the hand right down. But again, depending on the situation. So I like to say, and the school of thought is wherever your shoulder has rotated in the depth of the water. Let's go back to Patrick, because this might be actually pretty easy to show on that last shot that we had right there. Okay. So the hand comes in and then is driven forward to the depth of the shoulder. So wherever the shoulder has rotated to, you're trying to get the extension to that. Okay. So as his hand comes in, he's going down a little bit more than what I, you know, would have wanted, but boom, right there. So during extension, again, this point is to make sure that the arm is not rotated in or held in the upward position, which is where most people do it during extension. The hand is upward, which then creates resistance down here. And so the idea is that wherever the shoulder rotates to, you want the arm directly forward from there. How you get there is going to vary. Now, if Patrick were sprinting, the arm would not have gone below what is ultimately the line. It would have, he probably would have entered a little bit further out and the arm would have been higher, but we do want to get into this position. So that's ultimately what you're going for. But you just want to be careful not to do too much of this steep. You don't want the hand coming down and then going up like that, whereas Patrick goes just a little bit down, but mostly just gets it right into that position. Okay. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's for how deep you go. I guess
the angle could be
depend on your body shape and length of arm and so forth.
Yeah. I mean, again, it's all independent. And so you can practice if you really get into it, you can practice the really short entry and then what it feels like, and then start to move the hand out, to find the point where that's going to work for you, but making sure that you're not, the arm's not coming in fully extended. And you'll be able to, you'll watch people and you'll watch your students that when they rotate, if they're entering incorrectly, the elbow is actually what hits the water first. Because as they rotate around, if the arm is not, if you're not in the right position to enter, the elbow or the full arm hits at the same time. That's what you don't want. Something has got to get into the water first. And even with a straight arm freestyle, you want something, and you want that to be the fingers be the first thing that goes into the water. Okay. So extension versus too much shoulder roll. Again, the rate of the stroke, what the person's swimming, how flexible they are, you know, just there's so many different aspects to be considered here. But, you know, and even to the point as we get older, this position, not so easy to get into. Okay. So because of the, trying to release the shoulder and get the arm forward into this nice glide position, the arm might actually be slightly deeper than that because we're just not as flexible. But again, what you don't want, even if you've got a lot of body rolls, you don't want the arm going upward. Okay. That's one of the main things that we've got to avoid. And so there is a video in the system called bent arm extension for those of us that are a little older, that we're trying to do the best that we can rather than get this perfect image. Okay. Let's get through this. Okay. This is basically making sure that we are connected to the engine correctly and not just taking strokes. And so you'll see the difference here between Merlet, who's more of a distance swimmer, open water swimmer, and Patrick, that's more of a sprinter. Okay. Because of just how the arms are positioned. So here she is, what I call the hook or the catch. So the arm is set. And as the arm is set, we want to see the arm coming back at about the same rate as the hips are rolling over. So we're looking for this connection between those two things. So a little easier to see once we get underwater. All right. Now, Patrick has a good side and a not so good side when we really analyze this. So right here, and again, knowing that his arms are mostly straight, because we've already discussed this, he's mostly a sprinter. And so the sprinter has a longer lever, and he pushes that through to get greater hand speed. So you won't see as much traditional EVF on Patrick as you will on Merlet. All right, but here, this arm is connected. And so what we're looking at is the speed of the arm with the speed or the rotation of the hips. And so we want these things to be fairly equal. And you can see how everything kind of moves together through here. Now on his left arm, the left arm leads. So the left arm goes before the hips and it's a little bit delayed. And so I don't like this arm as much as I like the other one, especially from a teaching perspective. But again, the idea here is that this is connected to this. So those two actions are happening at the same pace and at the same time. So right there. So the idea here is that as you rotate, it shortens that the arm and everything kind of comes together at that point. Let's go forward here. So 49. So right there. So if the arm gets too far ahead, that in the way that I like to illustrate that, that's like throwing a ball with the arm and then the body rotates afterwards. So this is that everything is rotating together. Okay. Now, some people teach that you rotate the hips first, but I don't think it works like that. The idea here is that the arm has to be set in the power or the hook or the catch position, and then the rotation of the body starts to allow it to harness the bigger muscles and then move together. So it's very difficult to lead from the hips in the water, so you want to get them as closely connected as possible. So we'll see Merlet here, sets the hook, and now the hips will rotate and help pull the arm back. Sets the hook, so you can see the hips are still fairly, the right hip is still fairly high as the arm goes down. And now when she gets into this catch position, the hips will rotate, and then that helps the hips and the arm work together right through there. And then again, same thing, sets the hook, so she gets the catch position, and then everything is now working together to then pull the arm back. All right, that's a pretty quick one. Okay, because I've just been looking at the time. the same one. Okay, here we go on the wrists. Excuse me. So the tricky part about bending the wrists, and what you saw, Leo was the swimmer that we looked at earlier, is that if you have the feel for the water, you will see some people have a slight initiation of the catch with the wrist. If you don't have a good feel for the water, what can happen is that if you learn this and if you maintain that through the pull, when you get to the powerful part of the pull, the fingers will actually pierce the water rather than being flat. So the way that you have to think about this is that if you're going to bend the wrist, what happens is the wrist always has to be facing the back. So you've got to be able to articulate that in such a way that it's always facing the back wall. And we've seen like the Brad Tandy video of him doing that. It's like he's like a mime. It's so cool to watch how his hands stay absolutely still. And a lot of people, until you've learned that, if you get your hand in this position like that, it goes like this. So you have to be able to understand and learn how to flatten that out so that it's always kind of facing the back. And so that's a feel thing. And that's where a lot of sculling will come in and, you know, developing that feel for the water of how to platform that. So when we look at the wrists, if there's initiation of a bend, it gets flat under here. You can still see a little bit of a bend through there. But let's look at it directly from the side. Excuse me. That's pretty good right there. So pretty flat. So we're looking at trying to develop the flattest surface possible with the entire arm. And what I like to say is that when the swimmer gets to the shoulders, so when the swimmer gets the arm to the shoulder, the entire arm is perpendicular to the body. So the elbow doesn't lead, the fingers don't lead, that the entire arm is stacked on the side of the body. That's our goal. So right there, she comes in a little bit. She does what I do, a little bit of an in sweep right there and then goes back. So the idea, again, you're trying to develop as flat of a position as possible. And so a good way to teach that is making sure that there's never a break in the wrist, okay? Until someone really has just that supple sort of flowing feeling. When you're teaching someone, try to start with an isolation of a flat wrist. So how do you do it? We've got the forearm fulcrums that the link is in there. So that's very good. And then this, you can take a larger paddle and just turn it over and hold it in your fingers like this so that the surface covers the wrist into the forearm. So if you break the wrist at all, what happens is you're going to feel that paddle dig into the arm. Okay. Lana says, hard to break the habit, the bent wrist in the press, I think press with the heel of the hand. And that is what Brian said earlier. So pressing with this part of the hand, making sure that you're not doing too much with the fingers up here. So there keeps a straighter line. What I like about this is that Patrick, when you get right here, we just got lucky with the shot, is that you can see that there's that little space right there in between the paddle and the arm. So that's a good forward position. And then as soon as the arm goes down, the pressure of the water presses the paddle back into the forearm. Now, if he were to add more additional wrist bend in that, it would really dig in right there. And so you would feel that. So the idea here is that you want that paddle as flush on there as possible. And you can see that just that little gap in there that he's probably trying to roll over just a little bit too much with the wrist. But right there is a good one. No space between the wrist and the paddle. So right there, a little bit too much. So you want to make sure that that's as flat as possible. Have people think about their wrist, having people think about what their wrists do when they pull themselves out of the pool from below the water to holding themselves out on the side of the pool. Yeah, that's always good because the wrist, it has to be pointing back. So that's a good one, Greg. Okay. So this again, very easy, but you want to think about how that those wrists are positioned when you've got the paddles on, because we have to get to the next step, which is now removing the paddles and then trying to keep that long lever. Or, you know, again, Patrick is more of a straight arm freestyler as a sprinter, but the idea, there we are about the halfway point. And if we were right next to him, we'd see that that's pretty good from perpendicular to the body right there. So we've got that nice long paddle right there. When it gets to the shoulder, the arm, the entire arm, so nothing's leading. The fingers aren't leading. The elbow's not leading. We've got everything pushing back at that point. So that's our goal there. And then inside of the elbow. Now, we have to be very careful with this one, that we have to get the arm into this great EVF position, and then you're focusing on pushing back from here, or even... I mean, how often have you thought about pushing back with the bicep? Mostly we have such awareness on our fingers and our hands that this is where we spend most of our time thinking about how to pull. And if you can start to isolate, and this is one of those exercises that when you swim, feel this. And you can do that with fist drill. You can do that with, you know, sometimes paddles, but paddles are going to put more emphasis or feeling on the hand. And so trying to isolate, how do I feel the forearm? How do I just get this part of the arm activated? Now move it up to inside the elbow. How do I position to the inside of the elbow? You have to be very careful that it's the inside of the elbow and not the back of the elbow, because that's where people get into trouble, is the typical issue of dropped elbow means that the elbow is going to lead the way here and the arm pierces through the water. So the idea of isolating, how do I feel my forearm pressing through the water? How do I feel the inner elbow pressing through the water, which then will expose the bicep to pressing through the water? So it's very important that you identify what part of the arm it is. And so you can do that with, you know, activating it just by rubbing on it, or, you know, or just really feeling how much you can keep the elbow, how far back you can keep that elbow and all of this part of the arm pulling without losing connection. So a lot of this is just really thinking about it and isolating that. But your goal here is to get as much of this part of your arm pulling, which then also activates the lats. So I think Merlet is easier to see on this. It's that really good position. And you can see how, again, the isolation of the upper arm to get the hand and the forearm down into that position. So very little motion at all on this part of the arm as she goes through this. Gets the arm and it's almost like it pivots into that position and then pushes back with the entire arm. Yeah, I love that right there. Great view right there. All right, those are the videos for today. Now you can see when we get into next week, these are all races from NCAAs. And there's a bunch and it's very cool to watch. And so that is an education in and of itself, or watching these races. It was incredible to be there. And, you know, if it comes to a town near you, get tickets and go, because it's there. any races. I didn't go to women's NCAAs. I couldn't get there. It was too far away. Maddie had school. Maddie had spring break last week. So I was able to, and it was just, we just drove to Indy. So it was very easy to get there. And so the only races I have from women's NCAAs, as far as that I shot, was I filmed the screen on TV for Rachel's races and added the data, but then she was doing it live at the meet anyway. And as Tom says, and he would well know, because he was the coach of Wyoming for many years, fastest meet in the world, exactly what I talked about at the beginning of this. Fastest meet in the world, most exciting meet in the world, loudest meet in the world. It is just, it's an experience. I mean, you can't walk out of that place without being hyped up. I mean, it's just the way it is, unless your team got beat, you know, then, you know, but that happens. Barbara, on these videos, I mean, there were so many different ways to go about it. Explain why you picked these.
I don't know. I think I said the same thing last week. You need to teach your freestylers all these things, but not all at once. You're going to overload them. This is like 7 weeks of working, but I like to teach all of them and then just tell the swimmers, you're going to find one or two of these that really work for you. I'm just throwing a lot of stuff at you, but it's up to you to kind of experiment and find out which ones make a difference for you, but just not all at once.
Yeah. And again, even in those, there were so many little different little things that you can work on within each one of those things. And so, you know, it's really digging into it that I think is so important. So Dan did mention that Indianapolis, you know, Olympic trials are at a football stadium. And so we stayed right next to it while we were there. But there are a lot of seats. Yes, Monty has a question about shoulders. There are these things. I can't hear you. I love what you're doing, but I can't hear a word.
If you're trying to reach something very far in front of you, right, above you, you can only go so high, or you can do this, yeah, right? And your shoulders are now going off the perpendicular from the body. The question is, when you're reaching for the extension, do you want the shoulders to stay at the same position, never one ahead of the other, or a little bit, or what do you think about?
I mean, you know, when you're reaching forward, the body's going to rotate and this arm is back here. So yeah, one's going to be more extended than the other. I think if you try to stay flat on that, then that's going to be very,
no, but even when you're rotated, uh-huh, right, you can either have the shoulders, if I'm going in that direction up, okay, right, even when you're rotated, you can really reach and you'll twist and you'll move your shoulders out of line. The question is there a way to tell swimmers how to think about that?
So here's the thing, and I see where you're going with this. Okay. Now, if the lack of flexibility in the shoulders, okay, and this is where the bent arm extension comes in. We will do tests. I got a great picture. I can't find it right now, but I've got a great picture of three triathletes from Project Podium standing in the pool. Okay. And I had each one of them stand straight up and put their arm up like that. Okay. And I said, which one is the fastest? All right. And what you saw was that the shortest one is actually the fastest in this illustration, because the taller two guys, when they did this, their hips went like that. It was so much tension. And this guy was like this. And so, you know, it's one of the examples I like to use is that if you think this is extension, you know, if you've been doing this your entire life, you can almost disjoint that shoulder, go straight forward like that, and it doesn't impact your body line. Now, when you were doing it right there, as you reached, you started doing this stuff. Yeah. Okay. So when it does that, that's when don't force the extension, because the extension is going to impact the body line. If the extension impacts the body line, that's where you get it to that drill, bent arm extension, which means go as far as you can as long as it doesn't impact the line and the balance of your body. And that's where certain people, if they're younger, I say, go get a pull-up bar and hang there so that you can get that easy extension forward without, you know, without impacting the body line. And when you think about triathletes who spend all of their time, the rest of their days doing this and doing this, they get really tight up here. And so very common for the triathletes not to be able to reach full extension. And I see my friend Lana in here who teaches a lot of triathletes. And Lana, if you don't mind talking about this point, because I'm sure you deal with it all the time.
Yeah. We see the range of motion, like you said, is a big deal. So some people, they've learned they want to reach and they see the pictures, but they don't realize they didn't develop those shoulders as a kid. So I never say to them reach, because usually that pulls the body line out, and then they swim like this up and down the, you know, cause they're kind of going like this every which way. So it's more of a extend and let the rotation push the arm into extension or extend into your catch. But I never tell them reach. Otherwise they will do that and pull themselves past their range of motion, lose all power, and their shoulders hurt.
Lana, I didn't even see that you typed something in the chat. So I just saw you there, and I know you and I have talked about this before. So.
Yeah, that's basically what I typed is I've taken that language out, because I've learned when I say reach to an adult swimmer, they'll reach, but usually their body line and everything like you described goes completely out of whack and they lose all core engagement and they can't do anything then.
Yeah. Excellent. Thank you so much. And Greg and Barbara, with your masters as well. I mean, how big of an issue is that with you guys?
I find that beginners that have a lot of yoga experience, they're so flexible that they're constantly overreaching and messing up their body line. So I have to tell them to pull back a little bit.
I found it interesting hearing Lana describe that, because I don't have too many triathletes at the moment, but I did have a couple of very good triathletes, and that was exactly their problem. Is as soon as they tried to extend, and I would have used the word reach, the hips went way off. And so I tried to get them to rotate more into it. That helped a bit, but they still, their hips would be all over the place in order, because they were thinking, I need to get that upper reach.
So Glenn, can I say something on this?
Absolutely.
So I'm a physical therapist, and literally the muscle that we're focused on this, I think we would agree would be this, the serratus anterior, which is the muscle that's between and underneath your shoulder blades in the back. So if you can activate and get those guys more aware of the serratus anterior, that's the release. That's where you get that extra extension on every single, you know, stroke that we use. But it's the serratus anterior is the origin of that. So activate it by tapping it, like on a dry land, you tap it, you have, you know, reach up to the sky and you tap it, and then have them just, you know, stay straight up and then extend up to the sky. All that is serratus anterior.
There we go. Absolutely. It's never as simple as just reaching forward. The whole body's connected by these little lines. There was a song about it when I was a kid. Okay. But serratus anterior wasn't in the song, and so I don't know what all the things are called, but here we've got a lot of much smarter people in here than me, and so that is the sort of thing that it is so much overall body, and that it's not just so simple to just reach forward
inside of the scapula next to the spine, right?
Mm-hmm.
The backbone, those muscles right there that you can kind of put your hands, you know, have somebody put their hands underneath. And that's the muscle you want to extend.
Yeah.
Not just the shoulder. Beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, very good. Thank you so much, Nancy. Yeah. Appreciate it. Mm-hmm. All right. So I think we did agree, Barbara, that next week we're going to watch some races.
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, and then we'll come back. I think we have another week on freestyle. We've got to move down to the bottom half of the body. But while everything's still fresh in our mind, I'll make sure that we've got a bunch of races to watch next week. Just observing the meet is an education. of what we want to, you know, what we'd love to achieve. And the funny part was that at one point, one of Rachel's swimmers had asked, didn't Glenn win NCAAs? And she said, yeah. And they said, what did he go? Now, it just so happens that it was 41 years ago this weekend at Indianapolis in lane five was when I won NCAAs. Okay. And so I was back at the pool. And so I texted back knowing that Leon Marchant was going to go 146. I texted back 147. And she looked up at me and she goes, you did not. And I said, okay, I went 158. But look, it's 41 years, 12 seconds in 41 years. I mean, whatever. So, but it was such an exciting meet. I was texting some of my friends, you know, literally Olympic athletes, world record holders, and they're going, what is going on? It is unbelievable. I mean, the times are so fast. So it was a great meet. And I can't wait to share a bunch of the stuff with you next week. All right. Thank you so much. Everybody have a great week. We'll see you next week and look forward to it. Thank you. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.